Coming up, I'll walk you through everything you need to know about deploying Windows Virtual Desktop. Now, this is the second how-to in our series for preparing, deploying, and optimizing Windows Virtual Desktop. I'm going to walk you through all the steps and decisions to get to your first host pool and get that running. Now, to get started, you'll need to have taken a few prerequisite steps to set up your initial WVD tenant. So if you haven't done that already, please check out our first episode on preparing for Windows Virtual Desktop at aka.ms/WVDPrereqs. Now, assuming that you have your prerequisites in place, we'll look first at how to build our host pool, then move on to provisioning both full desktops and apps for users. Now, you can think of a host pool as a collection of session hosts. Now, these are virtual machines that your users will log into to experience either full Windows desktops or remote apps. So the first thing you'll need to do here is log into the Azure portal at portal.azure.com. Now, in the upper left-hand corner, I'm going to click on Create a Resource. Now, here's where I'm going to search for Windows Virtual Desktop. So I'll go ahead and start typing that in. And we'll see the option we want here, Provision a Host Pool. And now when we do that, we'll see a nice welcome screen, and I'll click Create from that screen. And now in the basics, I'm going to type the host pool name. In my case, I'm going to just call it My First Host Pool. And then we're presented with our first option. So this is a choice as to whether or not to create a pooled or a personal desktop. Now, a pooled desktop allows multiple user accounts to log into the same virtual machine. Pooled desktops in general are more efficient and less expensive, but because several users share the same virtual machine, in most cases, none of these users are going to be local admins, so you'll need to find another process to install apps and configure the VM. Now, a personal desktop is where each user has their own personal virtual machine, and this is useful for VMs that need to be dedicated to one user, and that user typically is going to be a local admin. So in my case, I'm going to go ahead and select pooled, and then I'm going to add my default users. Now, these are just the email addresses for, in my case, users of Megan B and Adele V, separated by a comma. You don't want any spaces in between that. In the future, we'll be able to add groups to that as well. Now, I'm going to go ahead and give this a new resource group. So this has to be an empty new resource group. I'm going to use WVD3 and select the East US 2 region for the location of where WVD is running my first host pool. Now, in this screen, we actually have a few options in terms of configuring the number of virtual machines. So we have different usage profiles, light, medium, and heavy. Now, you'll see as I change these different values, the size of the VMs as well as the count of the VMs will change with it. So we'll start with light, and you can see that I've got 3 VMs. With heavy, I've got 7. With medium, there's 4. If I change the user account, our user count, there's only, with 25 users, there's 1 VM now selected, and now I can do change size. Now, this will actually change the size of the virtual machine, and if I filter that, I can filter, for example, by machines that have graphics processors or GPUs, and if I wanted to add that here, I could select any of these VMs as part of GPU support for my virtual machines. I'm going to stick with the default here, then I'm going to configure a virtual machine prefix name. Now, in this case, I'm going to just add WVD to my virtual machines. And here's where I move on to step 3. Now, this is going to actually let me configure where the image is coming from to build out my virtual machines. So by default, gallery is selected. But I could also choose, if I want to, blob storage. And that would need to point to an image URI, which is a path to a VHD file. I can use a managed image if I'm managing my images in Azure currently. And just with an image name and resource group, I can point to that one. Or I can use the gallery. Now, the gallery has 3 different images in it by default: Windows 10 Enterprise Multi-Session with Office 365 Pro Plus. There's a version without Office 365 Pro Plus and a Server 2016 version. Now, I can also select the disk type. I'll stick with Premium SSD. Then I'm going to add my Azure AD user account here, in this case, Megan B at m365x222956, .onmicrosoft.com. And I will add Megan's passwords as well and confirm that here. Also, this is going to be how I log into my virtual machine. Now, here's where I can specify if I want to use a domain or OU. So in this case, I actually want to select a domain, not an organizational unit. I'm going to input my domain again. It's going to match what you saw above. And once I've typed that in, then it's going to ask me which virtual network to join. So here, in the previous step, we actually created our virtual network. So we're going to use the WVD network, and then we're going to use the same subnet that we created for our domain services account. So we're going to go ahead and select that from the dropdown, domain services, then we'll click OK. So now I've configured my virtual network and my subnet. Now I can move on to step 4. Now step 4 is where we actually input our tenant group name and virtual desktop tenant name. So we're going to go ahead and type our default tenant group. We're going to type in our tenant name, which is Windows Virtual Desktop in my case. And here's where we can actually decide how we want to log into the Windows Virtual Desktop tenant. I can either log in using a user principal name, which is a single email address, or I can use a service principal, which is better if you're using things like multi-factor authentication. In my case, and just to keep it easier, I'm going to use a UPN, and then I'm going to input a UPN, which is basically going to be Megan's account again. And we'll go ahead and add that. Then we'll add the password for Megan 2 times again. And now when that's finished, we'll move on to steps 5 and 6. Now the good news is, with step 4, you've finished all of the main configuration steps. Steps 5 and 6 are basically confirmation pages. The first one is a summary of all the things that we just set and configured with our number of users, our VM size, etc. And now on step 6, it's a buy page, which basically gives you all the terms of use and other verbiage around Windows Virtual Desktop. We click Create, and that's going to kick off the provisioning process. In most cases, this will complete in just a few minutes, and when you're finished, you'll have a full desktop environment to log into, and Azure will let you know once provisioning is complete. Okay, so let's log into a VM that we created earlier with Megan's account. So to do that, we're going to go to aka.ms/wvdweb. And this is our HTML5 client to be able to access Windows Virtual Desktop. So once I log in with Megan's credentials, you'll see that I have one option here, the session desktop, which is the default. So when I log into that, it's going to ask for my domain credentials. It's going to also ask if I want to use the clipboard and printer. And I can also opt to not show that again. And I can control these settings if I want to via policy, in case you don't want to expose those to the user or have that functionality exposed to the user. Now, once I open up the session itself, it's going to ask for a secure login for the domain now, that side of the authentication. When I click submit, that's going to actually log me into that virtual machine. So once I'm logged into the virtual machine, you can see here I've got a full desktop. I can maximize the window if I want to. Now, the nice thing is, once I do that, I've got full screen real estate, and you can see that I've already got the browser and all my Office apps pinned to the taskbar and ready to go. So that's the full desktop. So next, let's configure a remote app. So this is only going to display an app window and not the full desktop. Now to do that, I'm going to use PowerShell. Like we did in the first episode, we'll start out by opening an elevated PowerShell ISE window because I need to import and install the modules required for this. So you'll see the first couple of steps here are to import microsoft.rdinfra.rdpowershell, and then I'm going to install that. So now I can actually log into my remote desktop broker tenant, and we'll do that with Megan B's credentials in this case that I've defined earlier as part of tenant creation. And now I can do a get command against that RDS tenant for Windows Virtual Desktop 3 that we just created. Now we'll see that here, and it's returning the right things. Now if I do a get RDS app group, this is going to actually show all of the apps that are part of, or app groups that are part of that tenant environment. Now when I go ahead and click on a new RDS app group, because I want to create a remote app group in this case called Basic App Group, I'm going to do that here with these properties and parameters. Now I'm going to use the get RDS remote menu app commandlet and pipe in my tenant name, my host pool name, and also my app group. And now we see everything here. And now the nice thing is I can go in and actually see all the apps that I have installed as remote apps into that virtual machine. Now I want to target one of these apps. In this case, the app alias is equal to Word. And I want to use that to create a new remote app group. And I'm going to import that app alias into that app group as one of the apps. So I'll do that here, and I'm going to give it a friendly name. In this case, I'll use the same friendly name of Word. Now, one thing to point out here is by default, in our case, Megan's account is going to have an app group assigned to her, which is equal to the desktop application group. Now, for a host pool, you can only have one app group assigned per user. So I have to remove Megan from that desktop application group in order to add her then to the new group that we just created called Basic App Group. So we'll do that. We'll do that first, and then we'll add Megan to the new app group that we just created called Basic App Group. We're going to assign her user principal name in this case. And when I do that, now Megan's actually assigned to that remote app group. So here you've seen that we were able to create the app group, find the apps that we wanted, then basically unassign Megan from the old group, assign her to the new group, and now we can go ahead and add more apps to that if we want to fill that out with additional applications. So now to test to make sure this works, we're going to go back into the browser, and we're going to open up aka.ms/wvdweb one more time. I can see all the apps that I have the rights to access. In this case, you see that Word is here, like we just configured. And now I'm just launching the Word window only as a remote app without the rest of the Windows 10 desktop. So like we did before, we can maximize the screen. We can also go ahead and start using Word if we want to, and you'll see that it's very responsive and everything's there as you'd expect from Word. But because it's just the remote app, you don't see the rest of the desktop around it. So when I take it out of maximized view, you'll see that it's just the one app window. So now we've seen how you can have both a full desktop and remote apps set up for our users. And of course, you can add more and bulk assign apps and users to save time. So that was a quick overview of setting up our first Windows Virtual Desktop host pool. Now we've got a basic environment set up, but the next step we're going to focus on is optimizing WVD further using FSLogix profiles to enable stateful roaming of users between virtual machines. Keep watching this playlist to continue, or go to aka.ms/wvdoptimization and we'll see you there.